In this video, we're going to talk about Windows Server 2016 and Storage Spaces Direct, and we'll be covering some of the interesting concepts around Storage Spaces Direct. So the first thing is, what is it? Well, it's the ability to use industry standard servers with local attached drives to create highly available, highly scalable software-defined storage at a fraction of the cost of traditional SAN or NAS arrays. It can be used for converged or hyper-converged architectures, and we'll look at that. And it achieves high performance by using caching, storage tiers, and erasure coding with technologies like NVMe drives and RDMA. And then Storage Spaces Direct is included in Windows Server 2016 Data Center Edition. If we look at the entire stack before we get into some of the specifics, I'm going to start at the bottom where you have this storage pool, which can have a mix of drive types. The next layer is this software storage bus, and there's actually a lot of intelligence in this storage bus, and we'll see some of the effects it can have on the storage pool. And then you've got your physical cluster with the networking, so you've got Ethernet, generally high-speed Ethernet, 10 gigabit or 40 gigabit a second, and also RDMA is in that layer. And then the storage spaces software, the storage spaces technology. And then on top of that, you've got the cluster volumes. And the cluster volumes are basically where the shares reside, and those shares are exposed on the network so that the physical servers with the workloads can mount those shares or access those shares and then get to the storage below. So in a converged environment, the storage and compute are in different clusters. It layers a scale-out file server atop Storage Spaces Direct, and then provides network-attached storage using the SMB3 file shares. And it really is for highly scalable environments, for service providers and also enterprises. You can see that you've got the Storage Spaces Direct on the bottom, and all the shares in the scale-out file system on top, and then the actual servers, the Hyper-V workloads, SQL Server workloads, whatever in those servers, accessing that storage, which storage just looks like a big pool of storage. It could be one big C drive if that's what you wanted. And we'll look at how that's done in a moment. And there's also a hyperconverged. So there's one cluster for compute and storage. It runs the workload directly on the servers, providing the storage. So the storage is in those servers as well. And it stores files on local volumes as opposed to volumes over the network. And then it creates a local storage pool for Hyper-V and other workloads. Now let's switch gears and get a little more detailed on the drive types and some of the combinations. So the drive types, NVMe, non-volatile memory express drives that can be connected directly to the PCIe bus. And then there's SATA and SAS SSDs, and then hard disk drives or spinning disks. And you can also create multi-drive environments. In deployments with multiple types of drives, Storage Spaces Direct automatically uses all drives of the fastest type for caching. We'll talk more about caching, but the system caches data on behalf of the application, and the remaining drives are used for capacity. Which type is fastest is determined according to the hierarchy. So NVMe obviously is fastest, then SSD, and then hard disk drives. And there's a number of all-flash deployment possibilities. So all-flash deployments aim to maximize storage performance, do not include the rotational hard disk drive. So you can create all-flash environments if you want. On the left, you can see an all NVMe environment, or you can have NVMe for the caching of the SSD drives, or you can just have SSDs. And hybrid deployments are possible as well. So hybrid deployments aim to balance performance and capacity, or to maximize capacity, and generally include rotational hard disk drives, or HDDs. In this case, on the left, you have the NVMe environment first, NVMe's for cache, and then the hard disk drives are for capacity. Or you can have SSDs for cache and hard disk drives for capacity, or you can have NVMe and then SSDs and hard disk drives for capacity if that's how you want it configured. And a quick look at the cache drive summary. So we have deployment, cache drives, capacity drives, and cache behavior. For deployment, if it's all NVMe, there are no cache drives, right? You don't have a higher speed drive in the system. They're all high speed. And the capacity drives are NVMe. Cache behavior is write only. And then if it's all SSD, there are no cache drives in that case. The capacity drives are SSDs as well, and it can be just write only. And then NVMe plus SSD, the cache drives are NVMe, the capacity drives are SSD, and that's generally write only. I'll show you an example. And then NVMe plus the hard disk drives, you would use NVMe for the cache. The capacity would be the hard disk drives, and that can be read and write because it's coming out of the NVMe drives. And then SSD plus hard disk drives, the SSD would be the cache drive, the capacity drive would be the hard disk drive, and you can do read and writes out of the SSD for cache. And then NVMe plus SSD plus HDD, the cache drives would be the NVMe, and the capacity drives would be the SSD and the hard disk drives. And you can do a read and write for the hard disk drives, and then write only for the SSD in terms of cache behavior. And you can set the cache behavior manually, but it's also automatic by default. So on the left-hand side here, you can see the NVMe going to SSDs. And like I mentioned in the previous slide, only writes are cached. So you would cache the write via the NVMe, but reads are not. So you would read directly from the SSD. Now, in a hybrid environment where you've got SSDs that front-end hard disk drive, spinning disks, then the writes are cached, and the reads are cached as well. So there's no direct read into storage spaces direct if you're using hard disk drives. And then a quick look at automatic cache and drive failover. So if you have a SSD that fails, obviously some drives don't have cache, and the system will automatically balance that out. And here's another example. You have an SSD that goes down. The drives aren't accessible. Another SSD takes its place, and then those drives are accessible. Drive bindings are dynamic as well. You can see here you've got NVMe drives that are bound to these hard disk drives. Well, what happens if you want to add more drives? Well, now you don't have an appropriate relationship. And so you want a cache drive to hard disk drive or capacity drive ratio that makes sense. In this case, it's showing that it goes from 1 to 2, and 1 to 2 doesn't work if you add more drives, so then it has to go to 1 to 3, and as you add more drives, it goes to 1 to 4. You can also add other NVMe drives and keep the same ratio, meaning a 1 to 2 ratio if that's eventually what you want. But this video is just showing you what the ratios could and should be. For the server architecture, and what's important here is this is somewhat of a different look than in the previous slides, where you can see storage spaces, then cache and capacity. Well, one of the keys here is that there is a three-way mirror. So you're getting replication automatically. So you can see that it's replicating to various drives in the different servers in the cluster. And that's very important, and it's very much like Azure. If you know, Azure has a concept called Fort Knox, and one of the first things it does is triple replication of data. And this is the same type of technology brought to on-premises infrastructure. So that was just a few of the cool features of Storage Spaces Direct. So in summary, you know, you can use low-cost commodity servers and Windows Server 2016 data center to create fully featured storage arrays. And then multiple drive types can be used. We talked about NVMe, SSDs, and hard disk drives. And then multiple drive and cache configurations are possible as well. And then many of the caching aspects are automatic and fault tolerant and can be manually configured as well if that's what you want to do. And then the server architecture creates redundant data availability. So with that, I want to thank you for watching, and I hope that was informative around Storage Spaces Direct.